the sky this month with your host, Dave McDonald.
Welcome to the sky this month for March 2021. I'm your host, Dave McDonald. March is an exciting month. We have the vernal equinox happening on March 20th, and Mars is bright in the sky at night. We're going to show you about where to find that and some other celestial delights at the end of the show. But first, I want to show you a video clip about the Perseverance landing on Mars, which happened February 18th. And you're going to see some real live footage of the landing. And then following the video clip, I'm going to introduce to you Todd Barber, who is the lead propulsion engineer for missions operations for the Perseverance mission. Todd is the guy who got us from Earth to Mars. And I know you're going to be very interested in what he has to say about that journey. So let's watch this video clip of the landing of Perseverance, and then I'll introduce Todd.
We are starting the straighten up and fly right maneuver, where the spacecraft will jettison the entry balance masses in preparation for parachute deploy and to roll over to give the radar a better look at the ground.
Applicate indicates chute deploy.
The navigation has confirmed that the parachute has deployed, and we are seeing significant deceleration in the velocity. Our current velocity is 440 meters per second at an altitude of about 12 kilometers from the surface of Mars.
Heat shield set.
Perseverance has now slowed to subsonic speeds, and the heat shield has been separated. This allows both the radar and the cameras to get their first look at the surface. Current velocity is 145 meters per second at an altitude of about 9.5 kilometers above the surface.
Nav filter converge. Velocity solution 3.3 meters per second. Altitude 7.4 kilometers.
Now has radar lock on the ground. Current velocity is about 100 meters per second, 6.6 kilometers above the surface. Perseverance is continuing to descend on the parachute. We are coming up on the initialization of terrain relative navigation and subsequently the priming of the landing engines. Our current velocity is about 90 meters per second at an altitude of 4.2 kilometers.
OVS valid.
We have confirmation that the lander vision system has produced a valid solution and part of terrain relative navigation.
Priming.
TBA is nominal.
We have priming of the landing engines.
Back shell set.
Current velocity is 83 meters per second at about 2.6 kilometers from the surface of Mars. We have confirmation that the back shell has separated. We are currently performing the divert maneuver. Current velocity is about 75 meters per second at an altitude of about a kilometer off the surface of Mars.
TRN Safety Bravo.
We have completed our terrain relative navigation. Current speed is about 30 meters per second, altitude of about 300 meters off the surface of Mars. We have started our constant velocity accordion, which means we are conducting the sky crane, about to conduct the sky crane maneuver. Sky crane maneuver has started. About 20 meters off the surface.
We're getting signals from MRO.
Tango Delta.
Touchdown confirmed. Perseverance safely on the surface of Mars, ready to begin seeking the sands of past life.
Well, it gives me great pleasure to introduce once again Todd Barber, who is the lead propulsion engineer for mission operations for NASA's Mars 2020 mission, affectionately known as Perseverance. Welcome to the show, Todd.
Thank you, David. It's good to be back.
It's always great having you here. And what a landing, huh? We stuck it.
It was a very nice day on February 18th, just still riding that wave of victory and happiness, some weeks later. It's just fantastic.
So Thought it would be appropriate. We're just a couple weeks after that now, as we do this recording for the show. And so I got a few questions that I think the folks would be interested, our viewers would be interested in learning about. So let me ask you, how is it that you were selected to be the lead propulsion engineer for mission operations for Perseverance?
Yeah, I think it's, I tease the people and say, well, I've flown three rovers to Mars and haven't crashed one yet. So they asked me back because I worked Spirit and Opportunity in 2003 and four, and then Curiosity in 2011. Well, both of those times there was another lead engineer. One of those engineers is deceased, may he rest in peace. And the other has moved on into systems, you know, out of propulsion, I say to the dark side, into systems engineering. So I was kind of the senior person. I made a career in mission operations for 30 years. So kind of the heir apparent, if you will. And I was nervous about that. It was an extra set of stress to be the lead person. My team was only three, including me, but and we were all part-time on the mission. But a new challenge, and just glad it didn't fail on my watch.
And obviously, it's a good thing that things worked out. So you clearly are well qualified for the job. So
I credit everybody that built it and designed it. Those are the geniuses, and then it's just the honor and privilege of taking
it there,
baton and crossing the finish line.
Which is awesome. So let me ask you. So what kind of a rocket was used to launch Perseverance?
Atlas V was our launch vehicle, and that was the same as for Curiosity.
After the rocket launches with the spacecraft on board, how many minutes later, roughly, is it when the spacecraft is released from the Atlas V?
Yeah, I'd have to look back. It's on the order of tens of minutes to an hour or two at most, because basically you might have a parking orbit or something around the Earth, but it's on the order of tens of minutes to hours, because we have to get off blast off to Mars there.
Yeah. And so when it does separate hour-ish or so, like what direction is it heading? Where is it heading to? I mean, I know we're going to eventually end up at Mars, but how do we aim I guess is the question.
Right. So actually we time the burn, the injection burn to the Mars, the trans-Mars injection burn to be at the right location in the parking orbit to point us pretty darn close to Mars. And it's the Atlas V that gets us into the parking orbit, and then the upper stage is the Atlas there. And and maybe, I think it was the Centaur, maybe, I'm not sure which one it was, but whatever put us on the proper trans-Mars injection path. And that's essentially a Hohmann transfer ellipse between Earth and Mars. We don't quite aim for the landing point though, because there's some hardware that could end up impacting Mars. You know, some of the Atlas V hardware and Centaur and stuff. And so for planetary protection, we have to shoot to the side a little bit and make sure to miss, but not by much. You know, a few meters per second along the path then is enough to clean up the trajectory to get where we're going at Mars.
Okay. So then subsequently, you correct the path.
So we allow for 6 TCMs, trajectory correction maneuvers, between launch and landing. I watch a lot of golf on TV, so I say it's a 352 million mile par 6. And for everything I've flown, we've ended up with Eagles, 2 under par, because we've been able to cancel TCM-5 and TCM-6. This time we got an Albatross. We actually were able to cancel TCM-4 also. So we were close enough to being on target after TCM-3. We had a really good TCM-3, lucky too. And then that allowed us to cancel TCMs-4, 5, and 6.
And TCM stands for?
Trajectory correction maneuver.
Right.
And they're picked along the trajectory. The first one's about 2 weeks after launch to take out the launch bias. The second one's 2 months into the mission. The third one is 2 months before landing. And the fourth, TCM-4, is about 9 days before landing. And then TCM-5 and 6 are kind of emergency-ish burns very close to Mars, last day or two before Mars.
Well, and we didn't need those.
We didn't need them. We had 3/4 of a tank left in the cruise stage when we crashed into Mars atmosphere. So plenty of propellant margin this time.
Well, that's great. And exactly, that was my next question. What is used for propellant?
Hydrazine monopropellant N2H4. So pass it over a heated catalyst bed. and it breaks down into, all you can get out of that's nitrogen, hydrogen, and ammonia. All three are gases.
Yeah.
It's very exothermic reaction, so it makes a lot of heat. Those gases expand in a nozzle. So it's not like combustion. There's no oxidizer on board, and it's just that heat of decomposition or the monopropellant that gives us our thrust and corrects the trajectory.
So how many different thrusters are available to correct its trajectory?
Yeah. So we have on board, there's four Z-facing thrusters and four Y-facing thrusters. And I'll correct that. They're kind of in a pod. So on each side of the cruise stage, they're four at kind of 40 to 50 degree angles, pointed like this. And so none of them are pointing quite in the perfect direction you need, but that way you can get away with doing what you need for trajectory correction by only having eight thrusters instead of 12. You don't need roll, pitch, and yaw. So it's a spinning spacecraft. So you can use spin up and spin down thrusters on opposite corners like this to give a pure torque to spin up and spin down. And then you can fire all four at once on one side of the spacecraft and then rotate half a revolution, fire those. And that sends you sideways, a lateral maneuver. Or if you want to go up or down, you can fire like these two thrusters pointing down at an angle and their contributions cancel out except for the vertical direction. There's also thrusters pointed up like this. So that can, you know, force you down by thrusting out that way.
And while the spacecraft is rotating?
Yeah, while it's spinning at 2 RPM.
Wow, that's really amazing. I guess you already answered the question, like when was the last correction burn that actually was needed before?
Right. Yeah, I'd have to check the dates, but I'm pretty sure whatever that Friday was before Christmas week. So I think about December, was it a Thursday or Friday? I think it was a Thursday. I think it was December 17th. How appropriate, Wright Brothers Day.
Yes, the Wright Brothers. And we know that two wrongs don't make a right, but two rights made an airplane.
There we go. Bada bing, bada boom.
So that's really pretty amazing. So basically 2 months, it's just on.
Yeah, course. We had spacecraft turns to perform, you know, for pointing at the Earth for communication. So little, those are zero delta V maneuvers. They don't affect the trajectory very much at all, but they were required just for communication and thermal reasons too, you know, keeping the cruise stage pointed at the right kind of off sun angles. But for purely propulsive maneuvers, yeah, last one was 2 months out. And a first time event, I think, for any of these JPL Mars missions, we've always had to do a TCM-4. That's kind of a feather in our cap. We get to cancel it.
Wow, that's so cool. And so at what point is your piece of the puzzle as a propulsion engineer, lead propulsion engineer, done? When you hit the Mars atmosphere, or do you kind of help guide it all the way until you land?
Well, it guides itself because of this speed of light delay between Mars and Earth. So the last official duty is to watch it down the surface and cheer, you know, eat some peanuts and cheer. Because after that, now there's people, one of the guys on my team is a specialist for the entry, descent, landing propulsion, the descent stage. So he's going to still be looking at data, writing papers and all that. But that's more for him instead of me. So I'm actually off the project as of today. Yesterday was my last ability to charge the project with a charger.
Well, that's awesome. Well, it's awesome that you would have this auspicious occasion to be on the show.
Glad to be here. Yeah, it was a great historic journey.
So you mentioned the speed of light, and also at the point of where we're entering the atmosphere and landing, how many light minutes is Mars away from Earth?
Yeah, and it depends on where they are in the orbit. But for this particular entry, it was 11 minutes one way. And we talk about the 7 minutes of terror. So to paraphrase Adam Stelzner, one of our EDL entry, descent, landing leads, you know, if you do the math, by the time you see it hit the atmosphere on Earth, it's 11 minutes old and minus 7 minutes of terror. So that means it's been alive or dead on the surface of Mars for 4 minutes by that point. So we are just passive, but very interested observers on Earth.
Yeah. what What for you was the biggest challenge of the mission?
Certainly flying from home with COVID-19 protocols, and basically I only went in a handful of times between launch and landing. So that made it very difficult, for even more so for my teammates that had to put it together and integrate it at the Cape and get it launched on the Atlas V. They're the heroes, just being able to pull off that work. And then for me, always time management, just trying to keep that mission happy while still keeping my two prime missions, Voyager and SMAP, flying and happy as well. So that was a huge time crunch challenge for, and we had a compressed schedule too, because we launched 2 weeks into our launch window and it was a short cruise anyway. So what we usually do in maybe 8 to 9 months, we had to do it all the same steps in 6.5 months. So that was a challenge as well.
So things were moving along pretty quickly then, so to speak.
Yeah. We also had, you know, some people have noted we had some anomalies right after launch in the safe mode, and a few things. They've all been covered elsewhere, but our initial cruise was not quiet. So we had to learn how to fly it, deal with some early anomalies, and then things got more quiet as we went on.
Yeah. The all-important feeling question, you're there, and so are you watching it from home when the landing was happening?
Watching it from home, nervous, you know, not quite as nervous as I felt being at JPL before, but, you know, everybody on the screen was all the people I've been working with. So I shared their nerves and absolute euphoria, jumping, literally jumping up and down and cheering when I saw
Of course.
Couldn't help myself.
One of the things that was very interesting from the, we saw in a couple of internet sites, was the message on the parachute. So
yeah.
as it was coming down.
Yeah. So there's a tradition with the Mars rovers, I guess, at least starting with Curiosity, probably earlier, for some Easter eggs, some things that are little hidden things, people, challenges for the public to find, or artists wanting to sign their work, things like that. The most famous one from Curiosity was the Morse code in the wheels. The holes in the wheels were put as JPL and Morse code, so we could, and it was actually useful for figuring out slippage on the Mars surface. So we knew we couldn't do anything like Morse code the wheels. We would get caught and found out. So this was, I don't know who knew about this. I certainly did not. I think most of the team did not know. When the parachute came out, we needed some alternating kind of orangish, red, and white patterns, just so we know what clock angle the parachute's at. But unbeknownst to all of us, and including during, I saw this during landing, or later when they played the landing video back, it hadn't occurred to me, but one of the engineers at the press conference teased about a hidden message. And of course, the internet sleuths deciphered it within just a few hours. And what it is the JPL motto, Dare Mighty Things, which is part of a bigger quote from Teddy Roosevelt, which I encourage the listeners and the viewers to go look up. It's a really nice quote. Just Google Dare Mighty Things, Teddy Roosevelt.
Okay.
And that's our JPL mantra. So we hid that in the design of the parachute using a 7-bit ASCII code. And it's kind of clocking around from the inner circle, Dare, going to the next circle, Mighty, outer circle within the black ring, Things. And then we needed 7-digit ASCII. I figured this out on my own to get a high enough number to do the 118 at about 7 o'clock position. Because then notice after Mighty Things, we have 34-11-58 north, 118-10-31 west, which is the exact latitude and longitude coordinates for the JPL main gate. So we put our mantra and our locations for any potential Martians to find. A very good, clever Easter egg. I really like that. Surprise.
That's amazing. In order to get there, one of the things that you mentioned as we were chatting earlier was the rocket equation.
Yes.
And so as you're looking at your computer screen and using your software tools to decide how many thrusters you need to use, which ones for how long and all that.
I guess one thing to say about the rocket, I tease because I'm a propulsion person for 30 years. I say, if I don't do the rocket equation, use the rocket equation once a day, I don't get paid. It's not literally true, but when you think about it, I do use this sucker all the time. And very rarely though on pencil and paper, right? It's just built into our models and our computer programs and all this. But this was a famous Russian guy, I can't pronounce his name, figured out, you know, how basically how your momentum, it's a momentum balance equation for a rocket. So where the mass is changing because you're throwing propellant overboard.
Right.
So that's the good news is your vehicle's getting lighter. The bad news is you realize to get anywhere because of the big delta V or speed change requirements, you, most of your mass has to be propellant. So just looking at the terms, delta V is the speed change. And then the V effective, V sub effective is think of that as the exhaust velocity of the gases coming out of the back of the rocket. So the so it's linearly proportional. If you've got stuff coming faster out of your engine, you're going to go faster. And an ion engine, for example, has 10 times as faster stuff coming out the back than a chemical rocket. So you can get bigger speed changes that way.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, then it's reduced by this ratio of the natural log to the initial mass over the final mass. So if you're only using a little bit of propellant, then initial mass is barely bigger than final mass. So it's log of a number slightly bigger than one, which is almost zero.
And what was the speed as we approached Mars? How fast was Perseverance going?
Yeah, the number that we commonly hear bandied about and has to do with, you know, it depends on what reference frame and all this. But with respect to Mars, it's about 12 or 13,000 miles an hour. Right. So it's a little less than that. It's actually, and then as we get close to Mars, Mars gravity sucks us in and accelerates us a few thousand miles per hour. And then the key with the entry, descent, landing is taking out, you know, all those zeros and getting us from 12 or 13,000 miles an hour down to about 2 miles an hour. That's really true.
Yeah, which is amazing. Yeah, the atmosphere slows us down, then the parachutes, we have the rocket engines, the sky crane maneuver, and the successful depositing of Perseverance on the surface.
And we need all that because, as you know, Mars is funny because it has enough of an atmosphere that if you don't deal with it, it kills your spacecraft. Somebody else said that. And it doesn't have enough to help you that much. So that's why we need all these crazy things. The heat shield helps a bit. The parachute helps a bit. But we still need rocket-powered descent and sky crane to get a soft landing.
And it all worked.
It all worked.
Well, again, Todd, thanks so much. Congratulations on an outstanding mission. And thanks for being so accurate in your job as lead propulsion engineer for mission operations in getting us there so that we could all celebrate this amazing landing.
My pleasure. And I'll look forward to trying it maybe again in 2026 if we'd start the Mars sample return retrieval lander launch and things like that. Try to land on Mars again. We'll see if it comes to fruition. But maybe I can get to have some more fun 5 years from now.
Yeah, because that's really a unique feature of Perseverance is the samples that it's going to be taking and depositing those test tube-like samples on the surface to be picked up, like you said, with the Mars return.
Well, it's the field of dreams analogy. If you build it, they will come. So we're doing the first necessary step. We're getting the samples. We're sealing them in a safe way that they could be brought back to Earth. And then it's up to future missions to complete the relay race.
And another unique feature of Perseverance is it has a helicopter on board.
Yes. Yeah. We look forward to flying Ingenuity. The helicopter, you know, within the coming, I'd say probably months, weeks to months, but it'll take a little time. We got to find a good helipad and make sure everything's going to work. And it's all systems go for flight.
Oh, amazing mission and so much to look forward to. Well, Todd, thanks so much for being part of our show. We appreciate it so much.
My pleasure and clear skies to you all.
Thank you. I hope you enjoyed that interview with Todd. Now let's just talk a little more about the mission, and then I'm going to show you some neat things that you can see in the night sky. Here we see the Atlas V rocket with Perseverance on the top a couple of nights before the launch. The launch was on July 30th in the summer of 2020. And this is the route that we took from Earth to Mars. When we launched July 30th, the trajectory course correction 1, 2, and 3, which was around, I believe Todd said around December 18th, about basically 2 months before landing, and they didn't need course corrections 4, 5, and 6. So they scored what he called an albatross, absolutely amazing. and 350 million miles to get to Mars on this trajectory. And the green dot pretty much in the center of your screen is the landing site taken from the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter in Jezero Crater. And this is a panoramic view taken with the mass cam on Perseverance. You can see the rover there and the beautiful landscape. Look over to the left and you'll see a rock right there. And look at the amazing resolution. And that shows a rock that's pretty much windswept. So we made it to Mars and we have some great images on Mars and also some sounds with the microphone that was on board. Let's talk a little bit about the night sky. So this actually is in the morning on March 10th, 5:40, about a half an hour before sunrise. And I point out this morning of March 10th, because you look, you see, you've got the moon, Saturn, Jupiter, Mercury. It's very much a crescent moon. It's not a full moon like it might look there. Binoculars will help you out to find Mercury, but you've got three planets and the moon, and you can watch the dance of the planets each morning. They're going to shift a little bit. The moon is going to be out of sight on March 11th. So that's in the morning, March 10th. Then the vernal equinox happens at 5:37 a.m. on March 30th. Yay, spring. We're on our way to summer. This is a view from Stonehenge on the first day of spring. And on the first day of spring in the evening at 8 o'clock, looking southwest, you see Orion here, easy to find. You can't miss the moon. It's a crescent moon. It's a waxing crescent. We're moving towards first quarter, and you can see the planet Mars just a little bit north of Aldebaran and Betelgeuse. Betelgeuse, reddish, Aldebaran, orangish, Mars, reddish, orange. So I thought that was really kind of a neat color combination to be able to look at. And when you look at Mars, remember Perseverance is there. It landed successfully as you take a look at Mars. So really some amazing things happening during the month of March. I hope that you enjoyed the show and stay tuned for our show next month. We'll be talking a little bit about some years before the solar eclipse, the total solar eclipse happening right here in New Hampshire. So for the sky this month, I'm Dave McDonald.